Hi, and welcome to Secret Podcasten, sort of live at SecT. I'm sitting here with Peter and Raoul, who just got off stage talking about dissecting the boot sector, or more or less about Petya, right?
Yes.
So tell me more.
Actually, when we talk of ransomware, not only Petya, okay? The thing is, if you're infected, and you pay for the ransom note, okay? Mm-hmm. The only problem is, the malware author knows that you're paying, okay? Then it will tell his other colleagues that, oh, this guy is paying, right?
Yeah.
Let's keep attacking. Let's keep paying. So,
yeah.
So the main suggestion, my main suggestion is like, you try to have a backup of your system, so that when times come that you'll be infected with a ransomware, at least you have some defense. On your part, right?
Yeah, because if you keep on paying,
yes,
there's an economy for this, and they will keep developing better tools. Yeah,
they will keep developing and enhancing the ransomware.
So. Yeah. So, what made you look deeper into like Petya in this case, looking really deep into the mechanics behind Petya and how it affected the boot sector? What created that interest?
Actually, I've been doing some research usually. Like malware, Palantax and everything, but when I saw Petya and then it is impacting the MBR, we don't see that much malware that impacts the MBR, right? The master boot tracker. The idea is, I want to show how about try to like debug the MBR. Can we debug the MBR? Okay, so I was able to find out that you can actually use the tool, the box, right? And then you can actually go into the actual code. So when I try to follow it, it's actually kind of fun on doing the debugging for the boot sector.
Right? Yeah. Really interesting to see sort of the, as you mentioned, like it works in stages, the Petya malware. Really interesting to see the way you actually did more or less live debugging or animated debugging on stage. It was really cool to see.
I usually do a video debugging because if you do it live, totally live on stage, it's like it always gonna be broken.
Yeah. It's not good television.
Yes. And you won't be able to actually show what you really want the audience to see, right? So that's why video demo is kind of a bit better.
Many years ago, I wrote my own boat sector.
Oh, nice.
It read sectors. And the sectors contain a frog, and it dumped it into MCGA graphics, so the frog was shown on the display. And the only way to debug was to write new sectors and see if it works.
That kind of the same way Petya worked? It also more or less directly wrote to the screen,
yes,
right?
Yes, it is.
And displayed that typical Petya icon.
Yeah, and you saw old 86 16-bit boot sector code. Mm-hmm.
So. Actually, when I was still not in the InfoSec industry, I had a project with some other guys that, you know some of the discs some school universities that they sell the disc with some programs. Normally the students will just copy them or right. So what happened is we tried to make some program that will actually try to avoid the pirating of the disc. Mm-hmm. So we write something on the boot sector.
Somewhere there,
also the counter. So if they use it in a certain number of times, and then you only pay for 20 times, and then it will stop running if it is already 20 or something.
Okay.
Yeah, it's like boot sector is kind of hidden. It's there, but hidden area of the computing system.
Yeah, you mentioned that if you get to the place where the fake check disk actually start counting blocks, don't disturb the computer because then you're screwed. Because if you pay, you can't reclaim the contents, and if you don't pay, you can't reclaim the contents anyway.
Something like as I said earlier, it's like. If it is encrypting and then you decided to stop it in the middle, like 50%, once you get the key, it will decrypt the hub, and then you're actually encrypting your own MFT.
But I read some mention online that if you're really fast, if you see the fake check disk coming up and you break the computer, shut it off immediately, then it won't even have started encrypting the contents.
No, once you... Oh, it is in the... Still in the part where it says checking the until you reach the repairing the counting.
Yeah.
If you haven't reached the counting yet,
then it's possible to repair.
You can still get the MFT, but your MBR is ready.
Of course. But you mentioned this is only the was it the file table, the MFT?
MFT, yeah.
That's encrypted. Is it possible? I think you mentioned it in your talk. Is it possible to sort of brute force try to find your files, because files aren't actually encrypted, right?
Yes. If you like the guy that asked earlier, that you can actually use the hard drive as a slave disk, and then you can run your forensic tools.
And
then you can grab actually probably the forensic tool will actually pick the actual files by itself, right?
So hopefully that would work.
If Petya is not yet enhanced that much, right?
And I think that for some of the Petya malware, isn't actually the sort of the master key has been leaked, or published by the author.
Yeah, because I think it's about during the time of the WannaCry.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
Because he's trying to help the fight the WannaCry, so he released the master key. The problem is if you're at the time you're being infected, you can use the master key to decrypt. But if you were infected before the release of the master key and you already paid or you already have backup, then you don't have the chance, right?
True. Yeah, malware is an interesting field, and it's that race, like they are getting better, doing more and more real crypto functions and stuff like that, and the defender needs to improve as well.
Yes. It's like a mouse and cat race.
Yeah.
In the first version of Petya, I think the cipher was broken. There was presentations on SecT earlier on. The first versions, there was some minor screw up in the in the cipher, so that you could find the key much faster than brute force. I guess I fixed that in next release.
I haven't really understood the cipher scheme for Petya, and you didn't look into that either exactly.
No,
I
just look. I'm just having fun on debugging the boot sectors. Like, I didn't really look into how that, but it is. I believe it is using the Salsa 20. Yeah, I think the other guy is right that he mentioned that the key is there, but it is being deleted once the whole infection is done. So probably you can probably stop in the middle of the infection, and then because the key might be probably be still there, and then if you know where to get it, then grab it, decrypt the other set.
But it could be
you could do a cold boot attack.
Yeah, because I guess it's only in RAM, so it would probably be that if you shut the computer down, it will be in RAM, and you can do a cold boot attack.
Presuming that you actually know how to do anything
and
with
you know
a cold boot attack
to look for it, right?
Yeah, exactly. Well, anything else from Peter?
No, I don't think so. Maybe you could say just a little bit the words about, because in the presentation you used, it was called Boch, right?
Boch, yeah. B-O-C-H-S. Yeah.
And that was the like debugger which can debug both?
You can probably debug the. You mean debugging the file?
Yeah, but the interesting thing where you showed you.
Yeah, you can probably debug a file, but I suggest if you're debugging a file, you use a regular debugger. Mm. But probably for that, because you are debugging in the sector itself, so you can actually run some files and debug it there, because it actually emulates the DOS application. Mm. So you can still do that, but.
The interesting thing was that you demonstrated debugging the
master boot record.
Yes.
Yeah. That was the key feature for that tool, actually.
Yes.
Yeah. Cool. Well, thank you, Raoul, and we'll see you later.
All right. Thank you. Bye-bye.